Hello and welcome. You're watching and hopefully you're listening to Kicking Ideas. This is a live Facebook broadcast which will be converted to audio and distributed as a podcast on iTunes. We are a bilingual Brazilian Portuguese American English show, and we discuss all sorts of polemical topics in a bilingual format. I'm Yuri Kinjo, and soon with us, I'll be bringing in Robert Kolk.
Okay, he's one of our guests. I'm Yuri Kinjo, and soon with us, Robert Kolk. Hello, Rob.
Good evening.
Hey, guys.
How are you doing?
How's it going? I'm
pretty
great.
Good. How's the
hey,
energy?
I'm glad we're back. We're back, though. That's the best
we're
thing
back.
To say.
We're back. We're working. Last
it's
week, we
working
had a
today.
Bit of a... Okay, just let me finish the introduction here, okay?
Sure.
On tonight's episode, we're going to be discussing media bias. Do you trust your media sources, okay? It's always nice to mention as well that our channel has the main purpose of offering content for bilinguals of both Brazilian, Portuguese, and American, well, English speakers in general, okay? All Spanish speakers, welcome.
Y también los españoles, sí, claro, los que hablan español pueden también participar bastante y aprender los dos idiomas a la vez. You can learn both Portuguese and English at the same time. So please, Spanish speakers, come online.
That this is just a thought exercise, so please don't take us too serious, okay?
Exactly.
It's always nice. It's always nice being polite. It's always nice to be open for conversation, okay?
Right.
Now, Rob,
right.
I need to say this in Portuguese. Eu preciso falar
right.
isso em português, okay?
Vai logo.
Pessoal, tudo bem? Meu nome é Yuri Kinjo. Você está assistindo e possivelmente escutando via podcast Kicking Ideas. Essa é uma transmissão ao vivo via Facebook e, eventualmente, este vídeo será convertido em áudio e distribuído no formato de podcast via iTunes, se você for lá no seu... no seu podcast, no seu aplicativo podcast, no seu iPhone, você pode encontrar pela palavra-chave Kicking Ideas, ok? Nós somos
right.
um canal bilíngue, português brasileiro, inglês no geral, inglês americano, e também todos
right.
os falantes de língua espanhola são bem-vindos, ok? Meu nome é Yuri Kindi, tenho comigo aqui, tenho o prazer de ter comigo Robert Kolk. Boa noite a todos que estão nos assistindo,
right.
e hoje à
Good
noite
evening.
Estaremos discutindo... Media bias, que eu tenho uma dificuldade de traduzir bias, que seria uma preferência.
Preferências da média, né?
É preferência da mídia por determinados conteúdos, ok? Você
right.
confia no seu, na sua fonte de informações? O título, em inglês, ficou como Bias Hazard, inspirado nos,
bias
nos
hazard,
anos
yeah.
de videogame, ok?
Yeah, not bad.
E
I like
em português,
it.
Eu... É, eu coloquei como, eu creio que eu coloquei cuidado com a mídia, ok? Porque uh-huh. não tem como traduzir essa pegada, ok, Rob?
Right.
Não,
right.
Rob,
good.
Estamos com um novo formato, right?
That's right.
Um novo formato. Quer falar um pouco, Rob?
Sure, so our new format is going to be all about doing it a little bit faster, a little bit quicker. And basically, I'm going to ask Yuri some questions, Yuri's going to ask me some questions. We're going to ask the same questions to each other. And then we're going to talk about it briefly. And we're going to be done within the next 45 minutes. So this program is trying to get it within 45 minutes to an hour rather than the longer hour and a half, 90-minute version. And, I mean, sometimes we've gotten really long ones, about 2 hours long, way too long to have a podcast unless you're really got a long commute. But yes, we're going to try to keep the rambling down, and we're going to try to include a little bit more content in a short amount of time, okay?
E temos 7 perguntas. Esse é o nosso novo formato. Tivemos uma pequena interrupção. Hello, Rob. O vídeo
we're
foi...
here.
Temporariamente
yeah,
interrompido, estamos
second.
De volta.
Yeah,
yeah. Estamos de volta. E temos um novo formato com 7 perguntas, ok? Rob, essa noite eu vou pedir para que você, por favor, nos guie, ok? Então você okay. faz a pergunta, ok? Você faz a pergunta,
right.
você responde a sua própria pergunta e eu vou responder a pergunta que você fez também de acordo com o meu ponto de vista, ok? So, it's all yours.
All right, so here we go. Question number 1 out of 7. Do you think that most media bias is politically motivated? and I'm going to answer my own question. And of course, as the Young Turks, Cenk Uygur would say, of course it's biased. And the majority of it, for me, it's okay that it's biased. If you know that it's biased and you keep that in your mind, that the media has a bias in what they're saying. And the reason I'm going to give you for why it's biased, okay, everybody, I mean everybody, has bias. Sorry, none of us are completely objective. We all have what we say, like everybody says in Portuguese, cada quem tem sua opinião. I hate the opinions. Yeah, I absolutely hate opinions in what I think about. I actually hate it when people say everybody has their opinion and everybody's entitled to an opinion. That's the laziest argument. That means I don't want to argue with you and I don't want to offend you. I don't care if I offend people. In fact, I like offending people if it will make you think. If it will make you think. And if you can prove me wrong, great. Then I learned something, right? Then I learned something. So I think I don't get offended easily. You choose to be offended. But the idea of media not having a bias, that's craziness. When media tells you, we don't have a bias, we just report the facts, they're lying. I don't believe it for a second. When facts are reported, they're always choosing which facts to accentuate, which facts to push forward. There's a thousand things that happen every day. Some of it is important to certain narratives. Some of it is important to other narratives. These things really need to be careful to say if this is a real media bias or if it's not or if it's just facts. Even if it is just facts, you're still presenting facts that help to promote your narrative. So the idea that media is not biased, that you can choose any particular one, that nobody's thought about that to confirm their own bias is craziness. So on to you, Yuri. What do you got to say about that?
Muito bem articulado, Rob. Muito bem articulado, muito bem colocado. Eu concordo com você em muita coisa e tenho a acrescentar também. Eu acho que seria a palavra em inglês, pessoal, guarda essa palavra, é naive, ok? É ingenuidade, ok? Você achar Você achar que primeiro vamos partir do princípio. Vamos fazer a pergunta primeiro. A pergunta é, você acredita que as fontes de informação, a mídia é politicamente motivada? Você acredita que a mídia é politicamente motivada? Essa é a pergunta. Rob já deu a resposta dele. Eu vou dar a minha opinião. Primeiramente, eu acho que é o mesmo cenário para a maioria dos países. A maioria das mídias são controladas por pequenas empresas particulares, ok? São do setor privado. Então, você acreditar que a mídia não tem uma intenção própria, um interesse próprio, eu acredito que seja ingenuidade demais, ok? Então, eu diria que sim, a mídia tem o seu interesse próprio, por mais que os repórteres, ok? Eu não sou repórter, é bom lembrar disso, ok? A ideia do jornalismo, a ideia de se tornar um repórter é você ser objetivo e simplesmente você passar a informação ausente da sua opinião. Você só quer passar a informação, ok? Essa seria objetividade, mas eu acho que não. Você não deixa de ser você, ok? Você não deixa de ser você, então eu acho um pouco difícil de você ser extremamente objetivo. E também, como você mesmo disse, Rob, é impossível de você ser completamente... não expressar nenhuma preferência, até mesmo porque existe uma preferência que nós, em inglês, nós chamamos de unconscious bias, ok? Sem você perceber, você... uma preferência subconsciente, você não percebe, você está passando aquilo, ok? Isso existe, gente, ok? Então, às vezes você fala, eu prefiro contratar homem para um setor de... Isso existe, ok? E da mesma forma, isso pode existir. Então, existe muita coisa acontecendo. Como que você não vai selecionar o que você vai reportar, ok? Até mesmo porque, Rob, pensa comigo, você tem uma história inteira para poder contar. Não dá para contar tudo. Então, você simplesmente... Você emagrece a notícia, você compacta a notícia, você tira a história, você tira o contexto da notícia e você só joga a informação. Então,
exactly. And this gives what do you say in Portuguese? Destaque. It so gives a destaque. Highlight. It gives yeah. a highlight to what your political beliefs are or your preconceived ideas are. You know?
Tem so, uma yes. coisa, Rob, que eu gostaria de mencionar. Essa semana você fez um post muito interessante que você foi, de uma certa forma, censurado no Facebook, ok?
Yeah,
você foi crazy. Censurado no Facebook, ok?
De fato,
Rob, eu vi as fotos depois, eu não estava tão educado em relação ao assunto. Eu vi as uhum. fotos depois. Eu sabia, eu estudei história há muitos anhum. Anos atrás.
Right,
eu sabia
right.
disso, ok? Mas eu não me lembrava das fotos. E quando eu fui ver as fotos, de fato, o conteúdo é gráfico. Agora, right. não precisava ter censurado. Bastava colocar uma tampa em right. cima e falar, hey, este
this
conteúdo
could be, this could be
é
triggering,
gráfico.
Right.
Se você right. quiser ver, aperte aqui.
Right.
Então, se você está escondendo determinado conteúdo, é claro que você está demonstrando right. preferência, perdão. Uhum. É, yeah. Eu acho que as pessoas falam, ah, mas é o algoritmo que escolhe. Pessoal,
Give me a break. Give me a break.
Eu creio que foi no começo do ano passado, ou no right. começo desse ano, teve uma história, um escândalo do Facebook. Facebook, nós estamos aqui no Facebook. Facebook, nós te amamos, ok? Mas constantemente o Facebook se envolve
well.
Em alguns escândalos. Recentemente com Analytica, né? A Analytica teve right. um escândalo muito grande. Analytica e Facebook. Mas um anterior a esse foi, assim, o Facebook dizia que era o algoritmo que puramente escolhia as histórias que deveriam ser, que estar ali no top, ok? Destaque. Mas isso não é verdade. Haviam pessoas também filtrando as notícias
oh, yeah.
que... Então, sim, yeah. tem mão humana ali, sim.
Right.
Eu acho
oh,
que,
totally.
Para responder a pergunta, Rob, é quase impossível desistir uma mídia que não exiba preferência.
No, I don't think it exists. Okay. And again, the point that was interesting, I did, for those that don't know, I put up a picture in a conversation about why it's not a great idea to eliminate all firearms from a society because it unarms the populace. And the example I used was the massacre in My Lai, which is a Vietnam era massacre where the American military actually rounded up a whole bunch of Vietnamese citizens and just kind of murdered them for about 3 hours, murdered them, raped them, killed them in all kinds of ways. And I left a picture, which was, it was graphic, of course, but it wasn't grotesquely graphic in the fact that it wasn't showing exactly. It was just kind of showing some of the bodies that were left there, which, again, it could have easily been just put a censorship of like, this is graphic material, you know, make sure that you're going to click this, this, you know, I want to see it, or I'm ready to see graphic material. That could have been put on it. Instead, no, it was deleted. And I was blocked from Facebook for about 3 hours because of this. So the point is, like, I'm actually really happy that it happened, because that means that I'm pushing the buttons that need to be pushed. There, if somebody's censoring me, it's because what I'm saying is important. That's how I see it. I see if somebody's going to try to stop you from talking, it's because that what you're saying is important and it's challenging the powers that be. And at a certain
isso me lembra um certo país, Rob. China.
Right, China. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, and hopefully Japan stays relatively
neutral.
Neutral in that aspect. I might have to be moving to Switzerland at some point, but the point is, I would gladly move to Switzerland if I can continue to have freedom of speech. So yeah. I will look for
sempre bom ter oportunidade de expressar sua opinião.
To that point, I will definitely look for that. Yeah, well, we've lost
right,
everything.
Question number two,
the
Rob,
right
posso...
to freedom of speech. We lose everything. So let's continue. Write down
Vou
the list.
Para a próxima
your question,
pergunta, okay?
Yeah, my question to you.
All right,
or,
so can I ask you? Can I ask you?
Okay. Sure. Go ahead.
Posso te perguntar? Ok.
Go ahead.
Essa preferência da mídia, vou perguntar em inglês primeiro, ok? Is media bias a threat to democracy? A preferência da mídia é uma ameaça à democracia? Entendeu
okay,
a pergunta?
So, I get it. I get the question. I'm just wondering, are you going to answer it for yourself
posso
first?
Responder? Okay, posso
go
responder?
For it. Go for it.
Okay.
Go for it.
Eu acho que desde que você tenha liberdade de falar o que você quer, porque vejo mal nisso, ok? Não é uma ameaça à democracia. Porém, é de se entender que a mídia usa, sim, o seu poder e a sua influência para poder converter as pessoas a determinadas ideias. Existe uma certa propaganda por detrás disso, sim, ok? Agora, eu tenho que tomar cuidado, Rob, porque eu sou um pouco protetor do jornalismo investigativo. Jornalismo investigativo, ok? Eu gosto de jornalismo investigativo porque eu sei o trabalho que eles têm, eu sei o perigo que é para eles, ok? Então, eu acho que, especialmente em países como o Brasil, ok? Nós temos a Globo e eu acho que a Record, que seria os dois grandes canais. Existem outros canais, mas os grandes canais são a Globo e a Record, ok? E no Brasil é mais ou menos assim. A Globo tenta ser neutra, mas para falar a verdade, não é. Ela tem uma preferência política. E a Record, ela tem uma tendência religiosa. Todos sabem disso, ok? E existe, sim, uma certa disputa aí entre as duas. Mas eu acho que no Brasil, em especial, a reportagem investigativa, ela traz à tona, ela revela muitas coisas que os brasileiros não saberiam de outra forma. Por quê? As pessoas vão dizer assim, mas a internet está aí, todo mundo sabe de tudo. Posso falar a verdade? Eu não acredito que uma pessoa de dentro do quarto dela consiga revelar o crime que esteja, a corrupção que esteja acontecendo sozinha. Ela, né, por isso, eis aí o papel da mídia, né, de ter o seu papel, a sua função de estar revelando. Eu acho que tem uma causa assim, mais honrável, ok? Da mídia existir. Então, existe sim, mas uma ameaça à democracia? Não, porque eu acho que desde que protejam a liberdade de expressão de todos, desde aquele cara que está no quarto dele, até mesmo aos grandes canais, não seria uma ameaça à democracia. Agora, existe preferência política, sim. E por isso é importante você saber de onde você recebe as suas notícias. Rob, com você.
Great. Okay, so this is the idea. The question, again, I'll repeat it, is media a threat to democracy? And I think two things in my mind, I don't like democracy in the purest of forms, because what it basically says is we can vote to extinguish another group of people. It's like we could just say, okay, let's vote for it. All people with red hair, now they're going to be we're going to kill them all. That could be something that people could potentially vote for, and if that's what your democracy says, then you could go for that. And that's pure democracy. Pure democracy is not a good thing, because it is essentially mob rule. Now we live in democracy. We live in a democracy. In a way, this has given us rise to some of the worst leadership that the world has ever seen. Now I want to. I'm not for monarchy. Okay, when we say monarchy, that's a king, right? But at least with a monarchy, this is something I want you to really think about. Wrap your head around this. At least with a monarchy, they have to be careful what they do, because their son, their next in line, is going to be the next ruler. So they have to be super careful about how they treat the nation and how they deal with their subjects, how they deal with their capital. Whereas we've got people in charge now in democracies who have no children, who have no reason to be good stewards of the countries they're in, other than to fill the pockets of their own themselves, to write their own place in history. Mm-hmm. And so personal interest that it is doesn't have any kind of reason to continue in a good way. Okay. So for me, democracy is a bit of an error in the way that it is, but also media bias, is it a threat to freedom? This is what I would say. Let's change it around a little bit. Instead of saying democracy equals freedom, let's say that is it a threat to freedom? Now, media bias is essential for freedom. We have to have the ideas have to be presented in a biased way. Mm-hmm. It's important that I tell you guys with full disclosure, I believe in libertarian values. That way you know where my bias is going to lean. That way you can see the libertarian angle from it. And if somebody else comes with a different bias, which is I've got a bias of the progressive bias, or I've got a conservative bias, then you know where they're coming from. You can take in what they say, and you can make a decision based on that. If you don't have the bias, then you don't know where they're coming from. If they claim to have no bias, they're lying. They're just straight lying. You cannot be in media and not have a bias. I really just want people to understand that. So when you talk about the places like we've got CNN, who claims not to have a bias, but how much negative did they say about Trump during the election? Yeah. How much positive did they say about Hillary Clinton in the election? Mm. How much did they even say about Gary Johnson, who was the Libertarian candidate? Almost nothing. How much did they say about the Green Party candidate? Almost nothing. So we have four what we call kind of major parties in the United States, which could have produced four different candidates for the Americans to choose for. But instead, the media shows a bias and eliminated all of the threats to Hillary by showing her juxtaposed Donald Trump. And this is the big problem. So if we look at does media bias have to exist for democracy to exist? I think it does. Mm-hmm. Do we need to make sure that it does exist? Make sure that you understand that your media has a bias and which bias it's pushing for. You can usually see it by how it treats a candidate. CNN definitely is biased for the Democrats. Mm-hmm. I remember seeing in certain times the media in CNN really shilling for John Kerry. Really shilling for Barack Obama. Uh-huh. And it's always been in favor of one of the candidates.
So when não tem como esconder.
Right, and Fox News is the exact opposite. Uh-huh. You look at there's a guy on Sean Hannity, and everything I've ever seen him do since Trump was elected, and even before he was elected, was shill for Trump. He's like, oh, Trump this, Trump that, Trump this. Even when he does things that I would think that Hannity would be against on his character, it's not. He totally backs him up. He totally shills for Trump. I think this is a horrible way to think if you're saying that you're not biased. But at least with Fox News, you know they're coming from the conservative bias. You know they're coming from a bias of helping the Republican Party. But CNN and MSNBC, MSNBC also makes it clear that they are shilling for the Democrats. Uh-huh. But and if you go to
reasons, eu ia perguntar agora.
Right. If you do Reason TV, which is a what we call the libertarian shill, they are constantly kind of shilling for the libertarians. But and I'm sure that you can find. I mean, I found media that was shilling for Jill Stein, who was the Green Party candidate in the 2016 election. But
não
these
sabia.
Things, see, exactly. But this is the thing. I consume all kinds of media. And I want people to understand
melhor coisa.
This. I look at all sides of the media because if you don't look at all sides, then you're not an informed person. If you're listening to the stuff that basically you like, and you're not listening to the guys that you absolutely disagree with, then you have no idea what their arguments are. So when they're presented, you just say, oh, I believe. And I mean, you might even say, well, that's right. They've got a point there, and maybe we need to think about this. But if you understand where your philosophy comes from or your ideological points are, you can say, oh, well, this makes sense. This doesn't make sense, and I know why. And this is important that you always know why you believe what you believe. Well, because if you just – it's not like we're choosing our soccer teams. You know, it's not like we're saying I'm a Palmeirense because
exatamente.
I'm a Palmeirense because there's no reason. There is no reason for it. But it doesn't need a why. But if you're in politics, you need to know why. You need to know
seria
why you believe a certain way.
Seria interessante você comparar a sua fonte de uh-huh. notícias com a sua fonte de alimento, porque acaba se tornando o que você é.
Right.
E você acaba passando para outras pessoas, certo?
Right. Okay, so next question. Yeah.
Okay. Deixa eu só acrescentar, Rob. Eu acho que você deixou bem claro que quanto maior for o seu leque de informações, melhor para você, ok?
Right.
Quanto maior for, melhor para você. Porque senão você fica muito só na sua esfera e você acha que o mundo é aquilo, ok?
Yeah.
Nice. Vamos para a próxima pergunta, Rob. Essa é sua. Pode ir.
So, okay. So, this is number three for those at home that are playing the drinking game. Now you can drink a shot.
Nos ajude a contar. Essa é a pergunta número três, pessoal.
Number three. It says, should media outlets put more effort into stopping media bias?
Eu acho que já está respondida essa pergunta, né, Rob?
Yeah, pretty much. I already talked about this, and I think that definitely they should not put any efforts into media into stopping their media bias. In fact, they should always show their media bias and let them let people know where their bias is coming from. Okay.
A pergunta, deixa eu responder também, a pergunta número 3 que o Rob fez é, será que as fontes, as mídias, ok, os grandes canais de informação, os media outlets, os grandes canais de informação deveriam colocar, se esforçar mais para tentar parar, impedir de alguma forma essa preferência por determinados assuntos, por exemplo, esse canal tal tem preferência pelo lado democrata, ou pelo lado republicano, ou pela direita, ou pela esquerda, será que isso deveria ser interrompido? E eu acho que, bom, Rob já disse anteriormente que o ideal é você ser transparente em relação à sua preferência, porque aí não esconde de ninguém, ok? Eu acho que, por exemplo, se a Fox News falasse, nós temos preferência por esse lado, seja qual for, todos sabem qual, ficaria mais fácil você saber de que tipo de notícia você está recebendo, ok? De onde vem a informação que você está recebendo, o que você deveria esperar daquele canal. Você já espera, quando você está assistindo aquilo, você já espera que seja dito aquilo, ok? Então, de forma alguma, não. Se você tem preferência, seja transparente em relação à sua preferência. Agora, se você está querendo, né, falar, simplesmente expor os fatos, também não faz nenhum mal. É bem-vindo.
Right. Right.
All right, Rob, próxima pergunta. Posso fazer a próxima pergunta?
You're up, man. You're up.
A próxima pergunta tem a ver com redes sociais, social media, ok? Será que as pessoas teriam uma preferência? Será que as pessoas demonstram uma preferência contra, ok? Redes sociais no que se refere a notícias? E eu vou responder, ok, Rob? A pergunta é, em inglês a pergunta seria, are people biased against new social media? E o que eu entendi dessa pergunta, na verdade, foi, quando você vê alguma notícia em rede social, você tem uma tendência a tirar o crédito daquela informação, daquela, né? Você fala assim, nossa, tá no Facebook, eu não consigo acreditar, porque aqui pode estar qualquer coisa aqui, né? E eu acho que, assim... Eu acho que sim, muitas pessoas não acreditam no que eles veem em redes sociais. E eu acho que o escândalo Estados Unidos e Rússia, né, com a criação de fake news também, já deixou bem claro que redes sociais são manipuláveis, ok? A informação que chega até o seu newsfeed pode ser manipulada. Ela é manipulada, ok? Intencionalmente. E você tem que ter, sim, você tem que tomar cuidado. Aliás, você tem que tomar cuidado com qualquer fonte de informação. O ideal, realmente, é você montar a sua própria perspectiva. Você pega várias histórias e você faz, né, você tenta entender o que está acontecendo ali. Existe muita informação. Por favor, pessoal, eu acho que às vezes as pessoas veem alguma notícia no Facebook e elas simplesmente compram aquilo como a verdade. A única fonte de notícia que a pessoa tem foi aquilo, e ela compartilha aquilo achando que aquilo é verdade. Mas será que é mesmo? Ok? Então, eu não sei. Eu diria, sim, que as pessoas, sim, já chegaram a um ponto que não dá para acreditar em tudo que está em rede social. Rob.
Ok, so here's the question again. It says, are people biased against new social media? And I think we don't have to have the word new. We can just say social media, or certain social media groups. Okay. So there's a lot out there that I will look at, and I will look at who made it. And just by looking at who made it, I will think, okay, this, I'm not going to agree with it. That usually is the way my mind comes into the social media that I'm going to look at. Okay, I'm going to click this. I'm going to look at it, and I'm going to make a judgment of whether or not, even before I've clicked on it, I sometimes have that predetermined idea that I'm not going to agree with it, and that's really a dangerous spot to be in. What you want to use is your intellectual self-defense. Mm. When I say this, intellectual self-defense is an idea that I really want to kick around right now, which is there is a lot of what Yudi just said. There's fake news. There's stuff that's out there that's being promoted, that's trying to manipulate you into believing certain ideas. Okay, so it has to pass the intellectual self-defense of your ability to rationalize whether or not something is real or fake, or if it is something that is potentially harmful. This is really important for you to have this intellectual self-defense so that you're not manipulated easily. I've seen it before, and I think everybody's seen these pictures where if you crop a picture a certain way, it looks like it's a horrible thing happening to somebody. Mm-hmm. If you cut a video up and just put certain words together, those
muda perspectiva.
Right, it changes the total idea that's being kicked around. Mm-hmm. So what you get is these sound bites or these quick quotes that if you was to put any effort into distinguishing them. I want to go through one that's interesting. So there's a certain podcaster. His name is Stefan Molyneux, and I've listened to his stuff for off and on for the last, you know, couple of years. And yes, if you take like one like sentence out of the whole idea that he's trying to put across, and you just take that one sentence out, and you put a combination of those sentences in a thing, you can really make it seem like he's a terrible person. But it's right out of the context. Mm-hmm. So if you look at the context is what he's used it in, then you understand that he is not trying to hurt people. He's actually trying to make people make people's lives better. And I'll be honest to you, he does a channel that's called Freedom Main Radio. If your language is on the level, you should check it out. It's Free Domain Radio. You won't agree with everything he says. I guarantee you won't agree with everything he says. But he is looking for truth. He is an honest in his curiosity. I've seen him debate Christians. He's an atheist. I've seen him get a Christian woman tell him something really strong and really, really well-defined argument. And I've seen him say, that's a good point. I'm going to take that into consideration. I'll get back to thinking about that. You've made an excellent point. You've changed my mind. So this is not a person that's not an irrational actor. He is rational in what he does. But this is the idea. What I'm trying to get across is that, you know, you have to have intellectual self-defense to go through this. I don't agree with some of the things he says. I have to analyze those things. And I have to look at the data that he shows for those things. He's a very difficult person to watch. Young Turks is another one that's very – it's a very progressive
Young Turks,
show.
Young Turks,
right?
Bom.
Right? Mm-hmm. I imagine that you would. Mm-hmm. But yeah. Again, Young Turks, I have to really – I disagree with about maybe about 80% of what they say. Okay. But there's always that 20% that they get just right, in my opinion. Yeah. Because they really hold certain people to accountability. One of the things that they really want to do, which I really applaud, is they want to take money out of politics. They want to get the money out of politics. They want to get get it out of the corruption out of there. And I can be 100% in line with them in trying to get money out of politics, in that I don't want government to have any power. I think if government has power, then that's where that's how you get money out of the politics, is you take away the power that government has to pick winners and losers to government investing in certain companies and then not in others. It's completely unfair. If you think about what's unfair, it's when they take tax dollars that people have paid and give them to a company to do a service that could have been a service that could have been done by a free company on the free market. And
free market.
You know, I'm not one of these guys that's going to just like sit there and preach the free market as this perfect method. Of course, certain things happen in the free market that are could be considered bad. But I would say that government has no incentive to get it right. It's not their money. They didn't earn any of it. They just took it from the people. And if they didn't take it from the people, they just borrowed it or they just printed the dollars.
Tirar o dinheiro da política seria muito interessante.
Right, and I mean I'm all for that, and I like it when they do spots on how their candidates are not influenced by money. They're influenced in trying to do a better job for the people.
De moedas, sei lá, Mario coins, alguma coisa para eles, assim como para quem está ali, para quem trabalha, para eles terem alguma maneira de contar os pontos, mas não dinheiro, ok?
Right.
Coisa assim.
Yeah. Okay.
Rob, eu acho que você foi bem claro em relação a essa última pergunta. Próxima pergunta seria a quinta pergunta, confere? Quinta pergunta. Posso fazer a próxima pergunta?
Go for it, man.
Ok, eu acho que você não tem essa pergunta aí na lista, mas eu vou fazer ela aqui assim mesmo, ok? A pergunta seria, can journalism help people, ok? Uhum. Será que o jornalismo tem como ajudar as pessoas? Sim, tem como. É bem simples essa a minha resposta. Tem como fazer coisas boas, como seria o caso do Brasil, que eu disse anteriormente, que seria trazer à tona problemas que não tem como resolver de uma pessoa só resolver, ok? Mas também pode ser uma coisa negativa no aspecto de manipulação, ok? Então, minha opinião é bem simples, Rob. Você acha que jornalismo pode ajudar as pessoas? Ou traz mais bem ou traz mais mal?
Ok, well, clearly, journalism, reporting the news, has an effect on society. The interesting thing that I would say is human beings have not been around long enough with this kind of system to be able to really rationalize what they're taking in. For an example, I'm going to give you a really good example here. When I was a young boy in the United States, there were some kidnappings. Now, these kidnappings, these kids were taken, they disappeared and they died. And what ended up happening was as soon as those kidnappings had happened, it became a huge thing in the news, okay? I think a kid was like walking home from school and got picked up and was taken away from his parents and ended up, you know, being killed. Okay, so this is the thing. Children lost the ability, a lot of them lost the ability to walk home from school or to play with their friends without anybody, an adult around. Wow. These things happen because of the media. It's not because there was this mass of kidnappings. It's just that if there was a kidnapping in New York,
pânico.
Right, if there was a kidnapping in New York, everybody in Utah saw it on TV. Mm-hmm. All the parents got freaked out, and they think, there's these kidnappings. So there's one in Texas, or there's one in, you know, these things. I don't think statistically kidnappings were up, you know. And these kidnappings were
da mídia.
Right. And so what ended up happening is children lost the ability to play. This thing happens here in Japan, okay?
Yeah.
There's something goes through the news, and man, everybody gets totally extra careful. And what ends up happening is what happens to the kids. They lose their opportunity to play. One of the interesting things...
De novo, as crianças saem no prejuízo.
We don't... Right. So we don't know that what effect this will actually have on humanity over the long term. I think it has an effect that is both good and bad. It can present things that will be really helpful. But without intellectual self-defense, without you being able to put your rationality, your statistical analysis mindset in and realize that you're in way more danger driving to the store to pick up a carton of milk than you are being killed by a terrorist, being killed by being kidnapped, all these other factors that could be
terrorism,
mass shootings, all those
mass
things.
Shootings.
If we add up all of that, all of it, it's not even close to the amount that we get for automobile accidents.
A verdade é que as notícias ruins têm mais atenção.
Right. If it bleeds, it leads, is what we say in English.
Não sabia dessa.
If it bleeds, it leads. And this is because people like to see carnage. People like to see these things. It's attractive to people for some crazy, morbid, horrible reason. We like to see death and destruction. I've watched Brazilian news, and I'm like in shock by how much bleeds it leads gets put out there. I'm sure that there's better things happening.
Todo jornal nacional, a Globo faz isso.
Right, I'm sure that there's good things that are happening in Brazil. It's not on the media. It's not in the news. If there's a teacher who's somehow able to get his students to learn better, it's not on the news.
Desconhecido.
Right, it's not even close. And so, if we think about those terms, does journalism have a role? Yes. But is it playing the right role when it does? If it bleeds, it leads. We know these.
No.
Right. It's got to make you, as the journalists, those who are out there, you need to start thinking about, reporting on things that are more positive. Stop reporting on everything that's negative.
O problema, acrescentando no que você está falando, é que é o seguinte, notícia boa não chama atenção. E hoje, eu acho que é o seguinte, Rob, quem trabalha ali, eu acho que eles querem, igual, assim como nas redes sociais, não importa o conteúdo, importa a viralidade. Quantas pessoas, né? Quantos views teve aquilo ali, quantos hits. Isso é importante, né? Mais importante do que o conteúdo mesmo, do que do papel que aquela história, a mudança que aquela história pode estar causando às pessoas que afetam, né, aquela história. Ok, então, pergunta número 6, certo?
Number 6, here we go. Here I go with this. Let's go with all right. I'm coming up with blanks here. I think we might be able to just leave it with five. Yudi. I mean, I think we can say there's one that says sure. I have one more, but I think if you got one, go for
it. Número 11. Dá uma olhada na 11.
Right, number 11.
Pergunta número 11.
Okay, I'll ask that one. Okay, so it says, are there more reporters on the liberal or the conservative side? Okay, glad that you pointed that one out to me again. I had kind of forgotten about it, kind of skipped over it. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, this is unequivocally true that there are more reporters on the liberal side than the conservative. You want to look, are there more conservative reporters or liberal reporters? Well,
eu tenho uma teoria para isso, Rob.
Well, let me finish this part, and then I would love to hear what your theory is. But the point here is, we have there was a poll done amongst journalists in who voted for Trump and who voted for Hillary. Mm-hmm. Well, if you polled the journalists, how many do you believe were on the Trump side? It was less than 2%.
Whoa!
Were on the side of Trump. So, did we have journalism biased? Yeah, and I'm not. I was never in the Trump camp. Okay, I thought that he might win, simply because this is one thing that Jesse Ventura was quoted in saying. He was a pro wrestler who ran for governor and actually became the governor of Minnesota. And when asked about how he thought he would win, he said, "Voters are stupid," and I actually believe that what he says has a lot of truth. Reason we have Trump. Voters are stupid. Reason Hillary was even on the ballot, voters are stupid. It should have been Bernie Sanders versus Gary Johnson. That's what it should have been as far as the way anybody intellectual thinking about the thing, anything. The conservatives would have been able to do quite well if they'd have had somebody who was an actual conservative, and if the progressives would have been able to do quite well if they'd have had somebody who was an actual progressive. Neither side was happy to vote with who they had to vote for, and it's because, well, name recognition, that's the number one thing. So,
Rob, talvez existe um ditado, não sei se você já ouviu esse ditado ou não sei se existe em inglês, mas diz o seguinte, que as ovelhas seguem o pastor mesmo se o pastor seja a mesma pessoa que irá abatê-las.
Right. Well, if we think okay. about it, I don't think the exact translation might not exist. But basically, you're saying mm-hmm. is that the sheep follow the shepherd, even though he might also be the butcher, right? I mean, like that's the
yeah, exactly. It's basically
what you're saying. It's like mm-hmm. somebody's have. Do you know what shepherds eat? Shepherds eat sheep. so they're mostly seguir da mesma forma, right? And they're gonna follow him anyway. Yeah.
Mas eu acredito sim. Que existam mais repórteres do lado liberal do que do lado conservativo, na maioria dos países. E eu também acho que a questão dos números certamente está a favor do lado liberal, mas tinha algo importante que eu queria acrescentar aqui, mas fugiu a memória agora. Mas com certeza o número, eu vou voltar a falar disso, mas com certeza o número é maior para o lado liberal, ok?
Sure.
A próxima pergunta e última pergunta. Eu vou acrescentar right. depois. No final, eu vou fazer algumas anotações, ok?
Cool.
Rob, última pergunta. Eu tenho aqui, eu vou fazer aqui para você. Deixa eu só procurar na minha lista de perguntas, ok? Ah, sim.
Sure.
Deixa eu só pegar aqui para você. Só um segundinho. Sim, já tenho aqui a próxima pergunta. Ok, Rob, então. A pergunta seria, você acha que a mídia, de uma forma geral, eu diria no mundo inteiro, mas em especial no caso dos Estados Unidos, teve um papel em não somente a mídia social, não somente as redes sociais, mas a mídia no geral, executou um papel de separar o país, de dividir as pessoas?
Uhum. So is the media... actively dividing the country,
tearing people apart, right?
Does it actually engage in that? Okay, that's an interesting question. Do you want to go for it first, and then
claro.
I'll have it?
Eu diria que sim, Rob. Olhando do ponto de vista estrangeiro, ok, não estando eu lá durante esse período, mas eu diria que sim. E por motivos políticos e justamente por dinheiro, Rob, por causa das campanhas, ok? Muitos desses canais, eles são patrocinados, ok? Eles têm o fundo, né? Eles recebem fundos, eles recebem dinheiro, ok? Então, se você pertence a determinado canal e você sabe que você está ganhando dinheiro de determinada campanha, ok? Ou de determinar, ou por exemplo assim, você está sendo pago para poder falar aquilo, é claro que você vai defender quem está te pagando, ok? Uhum. Então esses grandes canais aí acabam, porque as campanhas recebem dinheiro e existe um interesse privado por detrás disso, mas de forma geral, justamente por existir dinheiro, a mídia não é capaz de ser transparente, ela acaba colocando não a opinião exatamente própria, mas a opinião que está... A opinião é comprada de uma certa forma.
Sure.
Eu tenho essa sensação, ok? Você acha que a mídia executou esse papel de separar as pessoas, Rob?
Okay, so this is one thing that listening to a lot of the, what we say, online media, the new media, we would call it. So listening to Young Turks, listening to different podcasts, even the one, I guarantee you one thing, Young Turks and Stefan Molyneux, they would not agree on anything except for that mainstream media has been bought and sold. Okay?
Yeah.
So that they would both agree. This is one thing where you could get Cenk Uygur, you could probably get, what's the other guy? Ben Shapiro and Stefan Molyneux.
Ben Shapiro. Okay.
Right. You could get those three guys, all right, to come into a room and say, can you agree on one thing? And I would say one thing that they can agree on, unequivocally, I think they would totally agree on this, that mainstream media has been bought and sold. And that not only does it report on a bias that is trying to create a divide, but it actually needs that divide to continue to run the business that it's running. And it's actually counting on it. And so
precisa da divergência.
Right. So it's trying to get that divide to grow, mm-hmm. and it's actually in its own interest. Because if we look at this is the way that we think about it. One of the reasons that a lot of people did not want to vote for Hillary Clinton, and I'm going to give you this really straight and forward, that Hillary Clinton, why was she not popular among a lot of people? Even within the progressives, they didn't like her because she is a war hawk. She would have gone to war really quickly with Iran and probably with North Korea, possibly North Korea. And who do we have now? This is the crazy thing. Trump just, I think you saw a post that I put up. Trump just put up this guy, John Bolton, who is architect. He's the architect of everything that's gone wrong in the Middle East up until now.
Eu vi a entrevista dele.
He's been an architect into this stuff. He would love to send all of the American military into all the wars possible. I know that there has to be a reason that he's got in that position, but I can't for the life of me understand how a president...
Qual a motivação dele, né?
Well, no, how a president who ran on the anti-war, let's not get involved in every war, just put his advisor, put in as his advisor, the guy who wants to go to war with everybody. There is not a single war that he does not want to go into. This is the crazy thing about him. And I know that I will catch some heat from conservatives. Conservatives might say, oh, Rob's just, you know, he's just totally anti-war. He's a pacifist. And I'm going to say this. I don't care if you think that there should be wars over there or not. This guy's been wrong on all of it. Mm-hmm. And now he works for Trump. So the only reason that you would have voted for Trump over Hillary Clinton if you were for the United States not going into lots of wars would have been because Trump had said he wasn't going to do more of this. And in fact, he's jumped right in. He's got all the people in line that were horrible on these policies. And it does not matter. It does not matter if you choose the right or the left in American politics at this point. They are both going to take you to war. This is what I've decided that you know, over the last 20 years that I've been watching politics.
Lamentável, lamentável.
This is what I've come up to find that it does not matter who you choose. They're going to go to war. They're going to change a candidate like Barack Obama, who ran on a peace platform. George W. Bush, believe it or not,
Obama conseguiu ficar com menos problema do que Bush, ok?
You really think so?
No aspecto de guerra. Dizem really que ele jogou mais bombas, né? Ele jogou mais bombas.
Okay, so he was at war for the entire length of his presidency.
Campanha. 8 anos.
The entire thing, he was at war. Bush at least had the first year where he wasn't. So the point is, he didn't do anything to stop it. In fact, he opened up more wars. The only thing that Obama potentially did was did the Iran deal that looked like Iran, they were not going to pursue any more war against Iran if they give up their nuclear program. The thing is that I want people to understand is Israel, United States, they've been saying that Iran's going to get developed. They're 2 years from a nuclear weapon. They've been saying this since Carter. They've been saying this for years. Iran doesn't have any of that capability from what people tend to
a mesma estratégia do Iraq. A mesma estratégia
right.
do Iraq.
Just saying they're going to get a nuke, and then when do they do? And so what if they do? Here's the big thing. So what if they do? What are they going to do? They're going to be just like Russia has nukes, just like Pakistan has nukes, just like India has nukes, just like North Korea has nukes, just like United States has more nukes. The United States has enough nukes to destroy the world 10 times over. Exactly. So does Russia. Yeah. And yet we're not freaking out because these guys have them. And I'm not in favor of nukes, nuclear bombs and any country having them. Mm-hmm. But the point is, why do they want to have them? They want to have them so that they don't get treated like Omar Gaddafi, like Saddam Hussein. These guys don't want to get kicked
Tomados
out of their country.
Do poder. Mm-hmm.
But here's the main thing. Even if Iran had nukes, which they don't, which there's I've yet to see any evidence that's come out into the mainstream media that says that they do. Even if they did, who says that they would be any different than Pakistan? Who says that they would be any different than India? They'd have them, but they wouldn't use them. You know, there's no guarantee that they're going to use them. And people say, well, they're religious idiots. They're not crazy. They don't want to die. Mm-hmm. If they use it, they're going to die. So the point of it is, I just really want people to understand that you can't necessarily believe what these guys, these warmongers, are saying. You just can't believe it. Because what they've been saying for years, and either they're right and they've been the only thing stopping nuclear war from breaking out over the world, or they're wrong and they're just sending a lot of people to die, killing a lot of people in the process, and wasting a lot of American tax dollars, and making the world an unsafe place.
E vidas também, né? Muitas vidas.
Right, and I mean, we're not even thinking about half. I mean, the amount of lives that they've killed.
Famílias.
All the people that have died in Iraq. They're like, I mean, we're talking about a million people, if not two. You know, if we think about a million people have lost their lives because of these stupid warmongers in Washington. So yeah, it's a huge thing for me. I don't like it. We're getting up to the time and I'm kind of rambling on about war,
Rob,
but let's...
Me dê só mais 5 minutos para eu acrescentar algumas anotações, ok?
Pode ser.
Uma observação que eu queria fazer é que nós também temos as nossas próprias bias, ok?
Right,
nós também somos bias em algumas
Guilty
coisas.
As charged.
E é bom a gente reconhecer isso, porque eu acho que do momento que a gente reconhece, a gente também consegue consertar, nós também conseguimos consertar esse problema, se a gente reconhece que a gente tem, ok? E tanto em relação, não somente à mídia, mas a gente também tem em relação a gênero, a idade, a inúmeras coisas, a várias preferências pessoais que nós temos, e eu não escondo de que eu tenho as minhas preferências também, ok? Como, por exemplo, Rob, você lembra quando teve o atentado na França, que todo mundo trocou a foto do Facebook?
Uhum. Right.
Okay.
Yep.
Naquela mesma semana, em algum país da África, mais de 140 pessoas ou algo assim morreram.
Right.
Então, por que que as vidas africanas custam menos do que as vidas francesas? Mas eu te pergunto, eu estou aqui me perguntando, que país foi esse? E eu não me lembro o país. Uhum. Então, eu tenho lá minha preferência. Por que que a notícia da França me chama mais atenção do que a da África, ok? Mas eu me lembro de ver isso. E eu também me perguntei, nossa, que estranho, por que que estão falando tanto da França, mas sendo que tem muito mais gente morrendo em outros lugares, né? Então existe sim. Isso aí. Outra coisa também, Rob, que é importante lembrar, é que assim, hoje em dia, existe uma fonte de informação muito grande de todos os lugares, ok? Do seu celular o tempo todo. E assim, são várias pessoas criando conteúdo o tempo todo. Então, o valor da informação caiu, né? Então, o valor da notícia caiu. E o jornalismo, que deveria ser a informação séria, tem uma pegada de tabloide, sabe? Ficou com aquela coisa assim.
Sure.
Já falei sobre a questão do humano versus algoritmo, que era importante, eu queria ter falado um pouco sobre isso. Eu acho que a maioria das empresas de informação tem um ponto de vista político, mas se eu pudesse escolher, eu gostaria de receber as minhas notícias de uma fonte não política, que não tenha um ponto de vista político, ok?
Uhum.
Porque senão você acaba ficando preso ao interesse daquela fonte de informação. E vale lembrar também que é bom você pensar em fonte de informação como fonte de comida, porque vai formar a sua pessoa e você acaba julgando as outras pessoas e as pessoas com quem você se conecta justamente baseado nas suas informações. Termino por aqui, Rob. Eu estou pronto.
Sure.
Quer acrescentar alguma coisa?
Just quickly, I would like to say, you know, you have to be willing to listen to people that you don't agree with. I've mentioned a bunch of people tonight that I'm sure some people agree with and some people totally disagree with. When I mentioned the Young Turks, when I mentioned Ben Shapiro, when I mentioned Stefan Molyneux, I listen to them because I believe that they're all rational actors within the realm of what they're trying to promote.
Otherwise, how can we have a conversation? Certo? Como
right, we can't be intellectually curious if we're not going to listen to the other side's arguments. And so I don't agree with Ben Shapiro. On purpose, I don't agree with Stefan Molyneux. On purpose, I don't agree with the Young Turks on everything. But I agree with them all on some things. And this is important that you keep your mind open. A lot of people say, Rob, you got your mind so made up about things. Well, there's a reason for it. I've heard most of the arguments for and against a lot of the ideas that have come to me. And so it's not something new when somebody comes and challenges me on something that I've heard a lot about. I know the arguments for and I know the arguments against. And then I can formulate, does this violate a categorical moral imperative? Does this violate the categorical moral imperative that is people are owners of themselves and that nobody can actually force you to do something that you don't want to do as long as you're not hurting somebody else? This is the main thing. So thank you again for your time, everybody.
Right on the dot, Rob.
We did it.
31st time. Yeah. Thank you guys for listening. I hope, you know, espero que vocês façam uso desse conteúdo. Rob, thank you so much for your time tonight. Eu sei que você é extremamente ocupado. And I'll see you next week, okay?
We'll see you next week.
Thank you, guys.
Bye-bye, guys.
Bye.